So if you are visiting with us, this church family would love to spend some more time with you, just fellowshipping. We're thankful that you're here. I'm Dean Delfoss. I get to be one of the pastors here at Country Bible. We are very glad to have you all with us this morning. Just a few quick things before we start our time together in earnest. You were given probably at the door a bulletin like this one. And if you open it, just on the lower right side, you'll see about some things coming up. I want to point out especially two things just because of their timing. This Saturday, and I did say this Saturday, we have both a men's event and a ladies' event. So please be mindful of that. That's July 17th. If my calendar's in my head's correct, that's this Saturday. So please be mindful of that. Sign up for those. Can be in the foyer. So more good things to come. Please be mindful of what's coming up that's provided for you, for your fellowship, for your spiritual nourishment, for your getting to know folks and building friendships that last for eternity. So be mindful of that. That's what's listed here coming up. So please participate in that. Also in that men's breakfast, at least, I will say that sons are encouraged to come. So please, fathers and sons, men of all ages, you're encouraged to be there. Scripture calls us to worship, and so I just want to read to you a little bit from Psalm 34. Psalm 34, it'll be on the screen. If you have your Bible handy, I think it'll mean more to you, but we'll come back to it a little later. Psalm 34, just the first few verses. Listen to how David, writing under the inspiration of the Spirit, calls us to worship. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. And then, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. You hear the deep emotional ache of, oh, magnify the Lord with me. I'm blessing the Lord at all times. Come on, let's do it together. Let's stand and let's worship the Lord together.
Both of his crucifixion and his ascension. But he says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Yet a little while and the world will see me no more. But you will see me. Because I live, also you will live. And in that day you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. We sing these very words of Jesus in worship and in supplication. Sing them with your neighbors to the living God. Sing them over your neighbor for their benefit and encouragement. And sing them to hear them new again, a reminder of God's good promises and and that your heart might submit to the truth of His word.
All here, and Lord, I just ask that you would help us to hear the word today and just help us to apply that to our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
We come together with many concerns, many things that rejoice us as well, but many concerns, some heavy, heavy hearts, and some things that were that downright give us fear. And so return with me for just a moment to Psalm 34. Psalm 34. David writes this psalm to help us understand the fear of the Lord, even amidst suffering and sorrow. Hear the word of the Lord, beginning in verse 1. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces will never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, and listen to me, and I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many good days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are towards the righteous, and his ears are towards their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. He keeps all his bones, and not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate righteousness will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. We're thankful for God's redeeming refuge that we take in him, especially in Christ Jesus. This psalm that speaks of David in trouble is related to our scripture passage today. Larry, would you come and read it for us?
Working now? There we go. It is working. I invite you to take your Bibles. Open up to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, and I'll be reading verses 8 through 17, our passage for this morning. I'll be reading out of the New American Standard Version. To sum up, let all be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead, for you were called for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing. For let him who means to love life and see good days refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. And let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. And keep a good conscience, so that in the thing in which you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better, if God should will it so, that you should suffer for doing what is right rather than for doing what is wrong. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this opportunity we have to come together, and I pray that you will give us your eyes and your perspective through your Spirit. Help us to see the world as you see it. Help us to react to the world the way you would have us react. Open our minds to your word that we may be able to have a deeper relationship with you. And this morning, be with Pastor Dean as he brings the message. Pray that you'll give him your words. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, scripture, I just want you to point out elders whenever they're up in front of you. Larry's one of our elders, and so please be mindful of that. He and the rest of us are here for you. This passage reminds me of an article that grabbed my attention, and it came out when I was in college. It's called "Some People Just Say No to Novocaine." Listen to this. The drill makes a little fast whirring sound. The patient lies flat, face flood lit, mouth open. Inside you see row upon row of glistening silver. Whirr goes the drill, burrowing in. Let me just stop right there and say, can you imagine any more terrifying sound on the planet? For all you who are in dentistry, thank you for being kind. The dentist leans in close. She's intent on number 31, the lower right second molar. She's wearing a blue jumpsuit, a white mask, black magic magnifying glasses. The patient, a retired government engineer named Orlando Martino, is in a sports shirt, striped trousers, and white pro walkers. His blue paper bib has been tucked under his chin. Classical music is playing. Like the smash up of things that just, like it just classical music and yeah. It's an utterly familiar scene except for one thing. By choice, Martino has received no anesthetic or other aid. No Novocaine, no noxious oxide, no hypnosis, no stereo headphones, nothing. There's just a patient, the dentist, and the whirring drill. And the pain. Yet Martino doesn't seem to do as much as twitch. His hands lie open, limp in his lap. He's apparently relaxed. And earlier he explained, "I am very curious about pain levels. I like it. It's very interesting when they're drilling down into your jawbone. You're in touch with your body." I'll just tell you, I can't relate. I have no idea what this guy is thinking. Absolutely not. I am just the opposite, and everyone who knows me knows that well. When I go to the dentist, like I'll do later this month, I want the maximum amount of painkillers allowed, even though I'm just getting my teeth cleaned. I want the legal limit. I don't want just a side of my face numbed when a procedure is happening. I want my whole head done up. I had a dentist friend in Louisiana, and when I went to go see him, he would ask if I wanted the noxious oxide or whatever it's called when working on my teeth. And I looked at him and said, "Bobby, do you not know me at all? Like, have you ever met me? I want it all. I want everything you're allowed to give. I want it all." And then just this past month while we were away, my family and I were telling stories of each other going to the dentist. And they reminded me of the funny things I said and did just recently when I had my wisdom teeth pulled out in my 40s. That was awesome. So if you want to hear funny stories about me, you can go ask my family. That'd be great. When someone agrees to this, to go under procedures, we want all the help we can get to dull the pain, to numb the pain. One guy who I was talking to speaks about his desire for as much anesthetic as possible. The dentist asked him if he wanted local or general anesthetic for his wisdom teeth procedure. And he said he wanted not just local, he wanted what's equivalent to the national or the international level. He just wants as much numbing deadness as possible. When I think about this and our passage before us, I ask you, don't you wish there was some sort of aesthetic for words that hurt? Of all the kind of pains we could endure, don't you wish there was something to numb the pain of hurtful words? In our passage this morning, Peter has been speaking, and Pastor Brad has done a tremendous job while I was out. We watched them all. Of walking you through how Peter wants his early readers to respond to a government, to employers that are unjust, and even wives as they relate to husbands or unbelieving husbands. And here in our passage, in verse 8, when he says, finally, all of you, he opens wide now the lens of his focus. No longer zeroing in on particular situations. He's talking to every person who names the name of Jesus Christ in out all these regions of Asia Minor. So if you're a believer in this room, someone who's put all your faith and hope on the risen Christ Jesus, there are echoes of this passage that are very, very much for us. He says, finally, all of you have a unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. And do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. And just in those first two verses of our passage, verse 8 and 9, you could hear phrase upon phrase that forces us into the company of other people. A very dangerous place to be, in the company of other people. Because when Christians or non-Christians do not act in ways that are commensurate with the verses that were just read for you, there could be tremendous pain that we need to endure. Peter wants us to be a people who do not give pain to one another as believers in Christ Jesus, verse 8. And when painful words come to us because of our attachment to Christ Jesus, verse 9, we're supposed to fight that impulse to fight back and respond in a way that seems absolutely counterhuman. So as we walk through the text today, let's just point out a few things as we go. If we can get all the way to the end of verse 17 where Larry read for us, we will do it. If we run out of time, then we will stop. By the way, that clock back there is out of battery, so I'm going to just make sure that you all don't throw stones at me by turning my clock on here. Good. Peter writes these four qualities that should encompass every believer. And as I noted, be careful to realize that all of them require you to be in contact with somebody else. Verse 8. All of you have what he calls unity of mind, agreement about the essential and most important things, unity of mind. And as much as possible, not let anything divide you. With as much opposition as we will receive from the unbelieving world around us, especially the more Christ means to us, and we desire and actually walk in a way that pleases him, we will get opposition from the world around us. Let us not be in opposition to one another. The one thing or person that binds every believer is stronger and far more important than any other issue. Period. As important as those other issues might be. This is a word for the church. This is not a word for society in general. It will become theirs by God's grace if unbelievers come to faith in Christ Jesus. But this is a word for us to have unity of mind and sympathy. I was tempted to make an entire sermon out of verse 8 alone. The past 18 months have seen such a lack of some of these things, especially from those who claim to know Christ. Sympathy. It means when one is hurting, you, the old phrase is just worn out in our ears, you feel their pain. You don't cluck your tongue at them going, "What a weakling." You get in the mix with them, and even if you disagree with their take on their situation, you realize that they are hurting, and you hurt along with them. You feel their pain. When the feeling starts to come back in your jaw after the Novocaine wears off, and the doctors told you, okay, it's going to be a little sensitive for, you know, a few days, so don't eat on that side. So even though the tooth is hurting and the jaw is hurting, what does the tongue do? The tongue does its best to A, not get in the way, but also to schlep as much food as possible to the other side of the mouth. The tongue feels the pain of the tooth. And like members of the same body, the body of Christ, we're supposed to feel each other's pain and not ignore it. This requires proximity. It requires us to rethink Sunday morning. As great as it is to come and hear a sermon, hopefully it'll be at least a decent sermon, as great as that mindset is, a greater mindset is to take what we learn and what we share in together, this gospel-enriched understanding of our new life in Christ, and feed it out to one another. Bless one another with it. Let us live in a way that is a testimony of the new life that we have in Christ Jesus. We were talking about pianos at our house. And when you strike one key of a piano, you don't just hear that note. You also hear some of the other strings tied to the other keys in the rest of the keyboard, depending on where it is in the register and pitch. Because when one note sounds, others are vibrating in a way that is sympathetic. That's what the word in English means. When one is moved, when one piano string is moved, others respond in a commensurate way. He commands us to be united in mind, have sympathy, and brotherly love. This is that love that recognizes that there is a family connection to us. In Sunday school, Pastor Brad quoted from Galatians 6, "Let us do good to all men, but especially those who are of the household of faith." As much as we want to see society change and some things happen within the culture around us, our own dear nation, we, by God's mercy, are a new nation. What Jesus swore, "I will build my church on this rock," Matthew 16. I am building this church, this kingdom, this government of people. We're a new society, a new nation. And the mark, one of the things that's to mark us together is a realization that, yes, blood is thicker than water, but His blood is the blood that binds us. So the kind of relationships that even if your family doesn't have the best relationships and things are a little tense right now and there's some falling out, you know in the back of your mind, it shouldn't be this way. We're family. Peter says, take that and dial it up by 10 and implant it on your church. Brotherly love. What would you not do for your son, your daughter, for your brother that you love? I have watched many of you care for aging parents. And it's beautiful. That's the kind of familial love that sees a need and sacrifices time and preference to get in the mix, no matter how messy. Finally, Peter calls for what he says, 30 calls for a tender heart. A tender heart. again, in line with sympathy, in line with brotherly love. Maybe a surprising phrase for those of us who maybe are not as much emotionally engaged in a situation as maybe Scripture calls us to be. We want to stand back from situations and look at it through reason's eye. That's good. However, don't look so much through reason's eye that you are not tender-hearted to what's happening. There is a reason for the outcry. Be mindful of that. Christ didn't come just to correct our thinking. He came close to the brokenhearted. He touched the leper. He healed the sick, everyone that came to him. And remember in Mark, we were going through Mark, those early chapters, they didn't have time to eat person after person. And he didn't say, I've got no time for you. There's a tenderheartedness to the heart of Christ, and we're to walk in that as well. And then a humble mind. That's one word in the Greek. I really like this ESV translation. A mind that is humble is not holding on to its own point of view. It is open, especially to God's truth. It is a humble mind. It is a teachable mind. It is humility. It is not only thinking less of ourselves, but it is, in fact, a desire to think more of the needs of others than ourselves. And again, when you think about Paul and his letters, Paul in Philippians talks this way, and putting Christ as a supreme example. The Lord Christ, who set aside his own glory, in a sense, or display of his glory, in order to serve, in order to come not only meet a need, but meet the most profound need of rescuing sinners from the right wrath of God. And I don't understand the transition between verse 8 and 9. Peter, it seems, keeps widening his focus beyond now just dealing with one another to even the wider circles of the world around us. But in it, there's still, I think he on purpose didn't put a, hey, now let me finish talking about relationships in church and talk about relationships in the world. I think he on purpose blends from one to the other because he wants us to understand there are echoes of the kind of hurtful speech that can happen even among the church family. Verse 9 is another verse that, if you were to spend time dwelling on it, is one of the most startling verses in Scripture and can really feel unrealistic. Look at verse 9. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, or some of your translations, insults for insults. Don't repay when somebody does something bad, negative to you. Don't repay that bad or negative back. And don't repay, put down insults, reviling, word twisting. Don't repay what's happened to you, hurtful words. Don't repay it with that in kind. Even though that's the most knee-jerk reaction. And we tend to say, it's only human. May I encourage you to change the way you think about that? It is not only human. It is only sinful human. The Lord Christ was 100% man. Writer of Hebrews says, tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. He felt the pressure to respond in kind more than you and I do. C.S. Lewis notes that the man who holds out on temptation for 30 seconds has no idea how strong temptation can be after 10 minutes. The longer you hold out on temptation to do something wrong, is the stronger the temptation can become. So Christ, being the perfect man, who withstood every temptation, even to pay back evil for evil or reviling for reviling, is the only one who understands the full force of what temptation can be. We are called to respond in a way that is counter-typical. It's just not the norm. It's just not what the typical response is. It's not something that we've seen in everyday society. To not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But then he goes on further and he says, but on the contrary. So it's not enough. I can't tell you how much wrestling I had over this text. I have to be in a position to be able to present it to you with some integrity. I completely appreciate that struggle at the beginning of verse 9, and Peter's not done yet. Peter's not saying, grit your teeth and put up with it, which is some of us on our very best day. He says, on the contrary, bless. On the contrary, bless. This is so much more than what we typically do. On the contrary, bless. Bless in the society that Peter wrote to, that Greco-Roman society, has the idea of saying good things in public about somebody. So when someone says something bad about you, you say good things in public about them. However, I think Peter is more reaching on to what Christ has taught and what we learn from the Old Testament scriptures, that more than that, it means to ask God to show favor on them. It's a life that realizes that we're living coram Deo, before the face of God. So that when we receive insults or our position is twisted and it's not represented right, I didn't mean it that way, I didn't say it that way. When our words are twisted, when our position is twisted, and we are reviled in culture or person to person, you don't respond in kind. You respond being kind. And more than that, calling down God's favor on that person. That's amazing. That's amazing to me. Again, just thinking about Jesus, Peter walking with Jesus through his ministry years, remembering back to the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount opens with these words of blessing by the Lord Jesus. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And when you jot down to verse 9 of that, just of Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you. Do you hear the echo in Peter's words? He's just remembering what Jesus said and bringing it to us. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you. The speech, utter all kinds of evil against you, falsely on Jesus' account. Jesus, rejoice and be glad. What? Rejoice and be glad. And now you and I would say to each other, that's just so unrealistic. It must be hyperbole. Rejoice and be glad. Here's Jesus' logic. For your reward is great in heaven. If you keep your eye on the big picture of the, just put it in financial terms, trillions that you are inheriting, you would not be so worked up over the scratch on a penny. Perspective is everything. So even for those of us who are suffering, even for those of us who have the hurt that we're supposed to be sympathizing towards others, when we're the ones feeling some of that hurt, that pain, that humility of mind is open to being reminded of God's grace, reminded of Scripture, reminded of the big picture. I won't so wallow in my pain, wallow in my situation, that I buck every attempt to lift my head and see the big picture. That is humility of mind. Our Lord calls us to rejoice in that day, because great is your reward in heaven, looking to the future, and looking back, for so they treated the persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the line of what it means for those who live rightly before God. You will be persecuted from front to back, for your reward in heaven is great. Someone put forth this illustration in a seminary class. He said, imagine that there's a Christian soldier living in a barracks as he serves in the military, and each evening he would read his Bible and pray before retiring, and he was reviled and insulted by the soldier across the aisle. And one night, as he's reading his Bible and praying, doing his nightly ritual, a pair of muddy boots come flying at him. And the next morning, the hostile soldier finds his boots at the foot of his bed, cleaned and polished and ready for inspection. Several other soldiers in this company eventually become Christians as a result of the inner strength of this one Christian who didn't return insult for insult, but blessed. Peter's saying that there is so much that is to be gained from walking in obedience to God. We are not earning God's blessing. Don't misunderstand verse 9, that so that there, so that you may obtain a blessing. We're not walking in obedience in order to earn, but we are walking in obedience because this is the path that the blessing will come. Ed Clowney explains this way: God, who calls us to inherit his blessing, calls us to follow the path of peace that leads to blessing. The Christian's knowledge of the blessing that he will receive from the Lord encourages and enables him to bless others, even his enemies. For to this you were called. That's a startling statement. Peter says, respond this way for two reasons. Mainly, for this you were called. For to this you were called. When the Lord suffered in your place, it doesn't mean that you would not have any suffering. He called us to take up our cross and follow him. To this you were called. To this way of living. To this knowing that even as I do right, I may suffer for it, as he will say in the paragraph to come. To this you were called, to not repay evil for evil, but with a blessing. And you will do it so that you will obtain a blessing. And then he grounds it with Scripture. Some people think that Peter was meditating on Psalm 34 when he wrote this letter. He hinted at Psalm 34 earlier in chapter 2. When he says, taste and see that the Lord is good. When I was reading Psalm 34, did any of you catch that? If not, listen. Even in Psalm 34, Peter quotes it here in verse 10 and following of chapter 3. Whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Psalm 34 is a great passage for 1 Peter's readers. Psalm 34 has a beginning little section to it that before you even get to verse 1 of Psalm 34, there's a little opening section that explains the history of what was happening when David wrote that. Psalm 34 reads, just at the beginning, before you get to verse 1, reads, it's of David when he changed his behavior before Abimelech so that Abimelech drove him out and he went away. So David is been anointed king by Samuel, yet Saul is still king and won't give up the throne. And David is on the run. He is in exile, just like how Peter opens this letter by calling us exiles. David is anointed to rule, but he's been driven out of the of ruling. He's now on the run. He's in exile. And he comes to this man, Abimelech, and after being driven out from him, wandering from place to place, sojourning from place to place, just like Peter calls us, David reflects back on that experience he had, and he says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will be continually on my mouth, even when I'm mistreated and I deserve to be king. It's an incredible line. It's a humble line. David humbled himself under the providence of God. You have destined me for the throne, and yet I'm in exile on the run. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will be continually on my mouth or in my mouth. In God's timing, this is David's circumstance, and David is submitting to it. And clearly, Peter picks up on that and dumps it into the lap of his readers, saying, this is the mindset we are to emulate. In these years that David was on the run, he had two opportunities to take Saul's life, the one who is abdicating the throne, the usurper, the one who doesn't belong there anymore. On the first occasion, David cuts off the corner of Saul's robe when Saul had unknowingly come into the cave where David was hiding. It's in 1 Samuel 24. And afterwards, Saul rose and left. David came out and called out to him from the opening of the cave. And after he called out to King Saul turned back and said, is this your voice, my son? You are more righteous than I, for you have repaid me good, whereas I've repaid you evil. So may the Lord reward you with good for what you've done to me. 1 Samuel chapter 24. 16, 17, and 19. On the second occasion, two chapters later, 1 Samuel 26, David spares Paul's life again while Paul is sleeping in his own camp. And he refuses to be the one to undermine Saul's God-given authority for this time. And so he takes Saul's spear and his helmet instead. And after returning to a safe distance removed from the camp, he calls out to Saul once again and says, I have not taken your life. And then Saul replies, the Lord rewards every man for his righteousness and his faithfulness. Blessed be you, my son David. 1 Samuel 26, verse 23 and 25. This is a real life situation of a man who gives his life over to submission to God's providence for these days. And it's a tremendous encouragement for Peter's readers and can be for us. Again, the principle is coram Deo. Our lives are not lived outside of the knowledge and intention and care of Almighty God. Notice the promise or the draw or the thing that just brings our attention to focus. Verse 10, whoever desires to love life and see good days. This is a description of the good life. All of our vain attempts to get good life for any other means, or believe the lie of sin that says, if you don't retaliate, they're going to think you're a weakling. They're going to take what is yours. Sure, in just this little instance, it's okay to duck into disobedience and go what I know is the best way. I know this is the best way. And God is calling us to trust Him. If you desire to love life and see good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good instead. Let him seek peace and pursue it. Why? Why do this? Why do this that feels so contradictory to the sinful impulse flowing through our flesh? Because another promise is made in verse 12. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. When you walk with integrity in obedience before the living God, you and I who have come to trust Christ Jesus, the Lord's eyes are on you. He's paying attention. He understands what nobody else understands. He sees what nobody else sees. He sees you. He cares about you. He's involved. The Lord's eyes are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. When we were listening to Pastor Brad's message on the passage that was earlier about husbands living with their wives in an understanding way, showing honor, this is verse 7, and then he says that your prayers may not be hindered. That was a sobering truth. That the way we treat our spouses could blockade the path of prayer between us and God. Peter is calling his readers to say that when you choose to walk in obedience, realize that the Lord's eyes are on you and his ears are open to what you pray. And then in contrast, the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. That is a sobering warning. We have two dogs at home. And the one's bigger, one's smaller. And when the big dog growls and is against one of us or against a neighbor, that's not great. When the little dog tries to emulate him and he growls, it's laughable. When the little dog is against you, you kind of just brush it aside. When the big dog is against you, you pay a little bit more attention. When the Lord is against you, what kind of attention should you pay? This is one of the reasons why God is the only person to be feared. We are called to this. We are called to bless when we are insulted. We are called to bless when evil is done to us. We are called to this. It is not unrealistic, but it is not easy. The Holy Spirit makes it possible, but he doesn't make it a cakewalk. Verse 13, which I think I'll save for next week, asks the sobering question of what happens when you suffer for doing what is right, verse 13 and 14. It is a remarkable truth that just continues to unpack what we've said. For now, I think you and I have enough to think on for the next week. Not only are we called to do what seems unusual, but we are promised the Lord's presence, his attention, and his help. It's a promise. And in the verses that were to follow, just if I was to keep unfolding this for you, verse 15 calls us to realize that Christ is the Lord and to treasure him. So when Peter quotes that the face of the Lord is against those who do evil, but the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and open to their prayers, the Lord in Psalm 34 is God the Father, and now we understand that it is also God the Son. This Christ, who is our Lord. As I think back through the passages that Pastor Brad presented to you from the middle of chapter 2 onwards, think about the Lord Jesus Christ when he faced insults and suffering and reviling. In a very clear way, we can say that the Lord was against his Son. so that he would not be against us. The suffering that Jesus endured, the reviling that he endured, was for us, so that now the Lord is always open to our prayers and attentive, but especially when we're walking in obedience. I think you're going to be tested on this point probably before you hit your pillow tonight. The text should be talking about the world out there that doesn't know Christ Jesus. I think interactions with anyone over the next several hours, family or friend, is going to bring some of this testing. You're going to get a chance to practice this. And that the other temptation you're going to face is, I'll just step back. And I won't be with people. This is what people do. I'm going to stay on my own. Don't do it. Believe the Lord. Unbelief is the root of every sin. Believe the Lord. He is with you. He will help you to bless even when you're insulted. Would you stand with me? As you think about this passage, and as the team is getting set to lead us again, maybe bow your head and just think through some of these things. Today can be a day of repentance. If the normal mode of your daily life at home, at work, at play, is to return insult for insult and reviling for reviling, today can be the day of repentance and rest. Father, thank you so much for your word. It is clear and it is present. And we pray, Lord, that you would come now and help us to, by faith, reach out and resolve towards a better course, trusting that you'll be there to help us hour by hour, each step of the way. We ask for your forgiveness. I ask for your forgiveness. You know how much of my life is not a good example to this flock in this regard. And I pray that you would forgive me and them and help us now to walk in the freshness of being forgiven in Christ Jesus. We ask this for your own namesake and glory among us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together. Amen.
What gift of praise is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine.
Everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You are dismissed.